Friends, we are very happy to inform you that e-modules are prepared for B.Ed. program in Telangana by the School of Education, Usmania University, under Pandit Madan Mohan Malaviya National Mission on Teachers and Teaching Scheme, MHRD, New Delhi. It's indeed our pleasure to share with the teacher educators and the prospective teachers and get maximum benefit out of it. It's a first of its attempt by us. We continue to add many more such lessons to share with you all.
A very good morning, friends. Today, as you all know that you have come into education and especially Bachelor of Education course where you are going to study various subjects. Amongst these all subjects, one of the very important subject in my view, I feel I am going to deal with you. Let me introduce about the subject in due course of time. Let us all try to look at human being as such, you know, all of us being human beings, we are very curious about everything all around us and we want to know everything, right from a small child to that of adult, we are very curious about it. So I will be dealing with you some such subject which you are really will be enjoying this particular subject throughout your semester. So this subject, before introducing the topic or the name of the title of the subject, I wanted to give you a small anecdote. In this anecdote, I just wanted your attention to be given to any book, any standard book that you take. In that particular book, you must have seen the preface, introduction and some of the contents, and then all chapters keep flowing, and then you will find one chapter at the end as my point of view, epilogue or postscript, something like that. So this particular chapter, suppose if it is a book on chemistry, botany, zoology, any subject for that matter you take, that particular chapter which I am referring to as postscript or epilogue will not be speaking anything either about the botany or chemistry or physics, but it is something saying about the holistic view about the book or gist of the book, core of the book, the focal point of the book. That is what is the philosophy. It could be this I would refer to as philosophy of the book. Similarly, you can say philosophy of a human being. Philosophy, like you have so many philosophers, so many educationists, so many botanists, like that philosophers will give their point of view in that particular philosophy. It could be pragmatism, idealism, naturalism, any philosophy, the philosopher will be giving his point of view. It could be anything about the reality, epistemology, all those things I'll speak to you in due course of my discussion. So this is how you need to understand that gist is called the philosophy of the book. Similarly, philosophy of a man or a human being or philosophy of a philosopher or an institution or a particular nation or a country, like that, the gist of it is called the philosophy or core of it is called as the philosophy. Let us enter into various aspects of philosophy. As you go on understanding this subject, it is something wonderfully makes you to understand. So I would say could be a derogatory statement or a very vehemently I would use this statement, there exists nothing without philosophy. That means everything has got a philosophy of its own. That is what we may call in the course of discussion. I'll speak to you about what is a point of view. So I would also use one statement to make you to understand better. Education without philosophy is blind and philosophy without education is invalid. So when you look at this statement, you know how important is philosophy as a theoretical dimension of education. Without this philosophy or a perspective, no education becomes meaningful and useful. So I would also use another statement, where science ends, there philosophy starts. All of us think philosophy is something abstract, we cannot understand it and other things. So but in a way, when you really look at philosophy as such, it is not exactly like science, which keeps gathering about the facts which are factual and other things. It goes much beyond those facts. It will speak about the universality of realities. So that's how you can go much beyond the science. That's the reason we can say where science stops, there philosophy starts. So in a way, we can say it's a rational attempt to formulate and understand the answers to all those fundamental questions which we come across in our life, whether it is day-to-day life or any kind of life. So there are varied perspectives and varied definitions we have about philosophy, and we can understand all this philosophy. I would raise some of these questions for you to make you to keep thinking. In other words, many of the times when I share with you students, I keep telling you philosophy is something thinking, you know, it needs thinking, it needs a kind of reflection, it needs a kind of questioning. You know, when you question, as Kelvin said, when you know double, you will know, you will be unknowing the quadruple. That is, when you know two things, you don't know four things. So two questions will lead you to come out with four more questions to ponder upon and then search upon and find out the answers to those questions. So this is where I would like you to come and focus on why actually the teacher needs this philosophy at all. What is this educational philosophy at all? And why we need to know as a teacher or a prospective teacher or any regular teacher. So my purpose of this particular subject to make you to understand and enlighten you is that every teacher need to have their own perspective. You may be reading varied perspectives, but you need to have your own perspective when you are dealing with your own children in the classroom. That is how a philosophy will enrich a teacher, empower a teacher with their own critical thinking, analytical thinking, and making them to really understand the whole environment of teaching learning process, and they will be able to put forth their own philosophical perspective in making you to understand what is the role of this philosophy in bringing forth this whole process of education and teaching learning process and enabling a child to learn and understand about everything. But when you look at the basic philosophy as such, so you must be thinking now, when I raised so many questions, what is this perspective, what is philosophy, how do you explore and how do you understand this whole lot of philosophy of education, and something must be going in your mind when you listen to this particular lecture. So this whole process, when you understand, this is a small picture before you. This is the Greek philosophers, you know, a kind of a metaphysical club where you can see various philosophers are there having a discourse and discussions. You know, this whole lot of knowledge came into existence with the discourses and discussions by using either deductive logic those days in Aristotelian times and later course of time with the Baconian, the scientific times or modern scientific times or modern philosophical times, Baconian times, 17th century, there they have come out with inductive procedures. So these are all related to logic. I will be discussing with you over a period of time. So some questions I am just trying to put before you so that you start thinking and learning. You must have seen a small caption given, a word given in blue on the top line of the PPT, where you can see something is written which is not English. Hope some of you can start guessing what could be the language. This is the language of Greek. In Greek it is written, all these letters you may recognize, some of those letters you may not recognize, some of those letters. These all letters you must have come across in your physics book and mathematics books, in equations and formulae, where you can see these all Greek letters. I will not get into the details of each and every letter. You can identify them by locating various words that are used or the alphabets that are used from Greek. These are all speaking about pi, the theta and lambda and the other letters. All these letters you must have seen in your equations, which means to say in Greek philosophy. So when you read this particular letters, you will understand it is speaking about philosophy. That is, the word philosophy derived from Greek, which is etymologically you can know love of wisdom. That means when you say philosophy, it is love of. Sophie, philo is love of, and sophie is wisdom. So when you say love of wisdom, I would refer to one of the great philosophers, Platonian definition on philosophy. He says, one who never satisfies with what he has acquired, and one he keeps on acquiring the knowledge, so he is called as a philosopher, and what he learns is philosophy. So you can see philosophy is not mere knowledge, but you are going much beyond this knowledge where you reach to the level of wisdom. So in a way we can say the person who is wise can acquire this philosophy, or wisdom level is philosophy. So this is where we can say, we can understand philosophy is not or cannot be equated or not equivalent to knowledge. It is much beyond knowledge, or it can go much beyond knowledge levels. So you can understand all these people who are wise people. And in other words, I would say, if you get knowledge about so many things, can you say that you are a wise person? Can I say I am a wise person? Can you say you are a wise person? So wisdom is something much, much beyond this knowledge levels. When you go and apply this knowledge relevantly in a right place, for a right purpose, for a right particular point of view, or for right things, that kind of a knowledge, you can call it as wisdom, or a person who uses knowledge appropriately is called a wise person. So like that, philosopher can learn like that I have given you a definition of the Platonian definition. In a way, I can comprehend to you what actually is this philosophy. In a nutshell, we can say it is a synthetic view, it is a holistic view, it is a point of view, or I can even say it is a bird eye, or it's an outlook on something. You may get an outlook about an institution, about a political ideology, or a country, or a human being, or a philosophy, anything, that point of view, that holistic view, that bird eye view. I would explain to you further what is this bird eye view. When you look at cricket stadium, somebody playing in the stadium, you can find holistic view of the stadium. You know, when they take the viewpoint or a camera, when they take from the top of it, then you can see the whole ground view. Similarly, a bird, when it looks down to the ground and wanted to locate the prey, it will take the holistic view of the ground. Wherever it finds its prey, it will jump down to that particular point and then picks up its prey. Similarly, philosophy will give you a bird eye view about everything. Reason why we can even say philosophy, there are varied points of view, varied definitions are given by various philosophers and educationists. So then it will help you in a way when you understand into deeper layers, much beyond the practical aspects or physical aspects or material aspects. When you are going and reaching out into the deeper layers of knowledge, philosophy will help you to understand that through or by creating some kind of a critical mind in you and reflective mind in you and putting you in the right process to arrive at the truth. That is how you can say about what is this philosophy, how it helps a teacher to build a point of view in a holistic way, and also it will help you to select certain perspective respectively according to your own requirements and needs, and also according to the children and context and classroom, you can select your own point of view or perspective. For your benefit, I would just try to focus on some of the very important definitions on philosophy. I would say the philosophy definitions have started with a small way of looking at what is philosophy. Levison said mental activity, Plato said it is a daily activity. So like that, if you see various philosophers, when they visualize this whole perspective and point of view about the world, about the self, or about anything in this world, what they speak in philosophy, I would speak to you about the scope when I discuss with you. So like that, it could be a science of science, or it could be a science of knowledge, or it could be a mental activity, or it could be analysis of some most difficult problems that man ever come across. Henderson said this. That means, you know, any difficult problem in life you can solve if you look at philosophically at that particular problem. It doesn't mean that it is like a solution to all the problems. All the problems, you can solve those problems by applying the philosophical analysis or philosophical approach towards the problem. So you can find solutions to all human problems by applying this philosophical perspective or philosophical process or philosophical understanding about the problem. So reason why we can say it is not a panacea to all the problems, but it is a process wherein you can find the solutions to all the problems that you come across. If you take a practical philosopher like John Dewey, he says it is not a panacea for the problems of men, but is that which emerges out of the methods employed by them to solve their problems. You can understand it is philosophy is like a methodological process that is involved in finding solutions to the problems. So that's how you can use philosophy as somebody's view, as I told you, as a daily activity, or you can use another very important D.J. Conner's point of view, criticism or clarification. When you say criticism or clarification, it helps you to critically view the pros and cons, positive, negative of anything. Also helps you to clarify some of the doubts or queries or doubts or anything, questions you have in mind, you can clarify if you approach philosophical process or methodology of philosophy. Similarly, it is science and criticism of cognition what Kant said about philosophy. Like that, you have so many viewpoints about what is philosophy. In a way, Wundt also found it as unification of all knowledge obtained by the special sciences in a consistent whole. So when you look at this beautiful way of looking at unification of knowledge obtained, you know, like you can look at scientifically, no doubt. I'm not saying philosophy is not science. Many people have some of the, you know, viewpoints, or they think that it is very, very abstract, a subject where we cannot understand. We can understand. Somebody said we can understand all these things as I would try to bring one of the philosophers, Russell, point of view. where he says if cannot be understood by common man in their day to day life, then it cannot be called as philosophy. That means even in a day to day life you should be able to understand. I will give a very beautiful one statement: philosophy is a life and life is philosophy. You know, it very clearly says that philosophy is equated to life. Can we understand life in a way, in a go? So that is how philosophy is something which is something very, very unique, like life. When you take for instance life is not so easy and simple to understand. As you move on, as you pass on, to understand this life you keep understanding with experiences, encountering so many problems and experiencing so many things in your life, you keep understanding what is this whole life as such. So in a way we can say life is philosophy, similarly philosophy is life. So it is that kind of a very deep knowledge that you need to get into and understand what is this whole knowledge of universe, man, self, world, God, anything, all this whole universe, and not only just physical matter or physical, you know, universe which you are able to see, witness through science or whatever, but it is much, much beyond that, what one of the branches called metaphysics will deal with it. Understanding this whole philosophy by taking into account what is this perspective. I have told you philosophy is like a perspective. When you talk of a perspective, what is a perspective? I just define perspective. What is actually this perspective? I can give a simple way of saying it is a point of view, or it is subjective, or in a way somebody's point of view. So it is a subjective view of some person, or it is a critical understanding about something, a subject or a human being, or about universe or God or anything, matter, anything. So there you are developing a kind of critical understanding about something. That is how we can say a point perspective is a critical understanding. Or in a very simple way we can say it's a creative thinking. You don't need to think in a normal way where everybody think in a way. So when you want to find a solution to a problem, or when you want to look at it in a different way with a holistic view, or with a deeper understanding about the subject or about a thing, then you need to have that alternate ways of looking at the things, where you can say it is a creative thinking. Philosophical perspective is a creative thinking, and a deeper way knowing, or deeply knowing about something, or deeply knowing or know-how about something. So like that, you know, when you are arriving at a point of view or a perspective, that means you are convinced with your idea that it is a right idea or an appropriate idea for that particular context or a situation. So in a way I would say it's a kind of a convinced idea, what you can call it as a perspective. Or in other words, you can even call it as a justified outlook, or much beyond all these things, or an approach towards something, what you can call it as a perspective. So then we can say how man starts, or how philosophers have started. If you look into the history of philosophy, I may not be able to bring that whole historical perspective in this class today, but in the next class we will try to bring or make you to understand what is this whole wondering process happened when man took birth. All of you know, primitive man don't know anything. He was not civilized. He had a culture, primitive culture, but he was not civilized. He used to wonder about everything around him. And he used to start gradually understanding around and start reacting to that, responding to that, and trying to adjust with that, and learn something from that, and get something from that, eat something, you know, kind of things that he was doing. So basically the very philosophy has started when man started wondering by wondering. You know, you are wandering around and started wondering about the things. Why the way it is? Suppose if you think about the world, why the way it is? Why a man is the way he is? Why God is the way it is? Why the matter is the way it is? So anything when you look at, you need to question, why is it the way it is looking like that? Why is it the way it is? So this question, when you start questioning yourself and start finding a answer to that question, you are viewing in a philosophical way. You are trying to develop a perspective of your own about something. So like that, you are trying to ask questions because you are wondering about the worldly realities or worldly wonders that you come across, or things that you come across, people you come across, whatever knowledge that you come across, you keep questioning. You know, Descartes says, I think, therefore I am. And he says, you doubt every knowledge, and you doubt every knowledge, and you don't doubt yourself, because I think, therefore I am. If you question your very existence, it is difficult. So you think you are there. I think therefore I am. Then you start questioning everything that comes to you and doubt everything. Then what happens? You start, you know, understanding and doubting, clarifying, and then you are trying to critically viewing the things and then coming out with appropriate solutions to all the problems, and you will be able to create and construct new knowledge which you can offer to this whole world. Upon the existing knowledge, you are creating new knowledge, the knowledge which is much more manifold, much more better, much more, you know, moving upward in giving you more clarifications and much more constructive knowledge and a critical knowledge. So this is how we can say about the meaning and purpose of life. When you start critically looking at it and reflecting upon it, and then you try to develop a point of view in a holistic way, in a reflective way, then I can say it is called as a perspective. So like that, when you look at anything as a educated individual or as a person with a critical mind or a creative mind, you will definitely start looking at the path of learning of the children and help them what should be the learning procedure, how should be a society, and what are the intellectual developments that are happening in a particular society, and what kind of intellectual inputs you have to give to your students, and how your own point of view you can develop, your own original viewpoint you can develop, and how you should not be a judgmental person about anything. Don't say right or wrong. Have a justification, have your own critical mind, have your own unification of the concept that you are able to understand and develop your own point of view from that. So like that, all the human values, all the human ethical issues, they all will develop when human being starts, or especially a teacher starts developing a point of view about anything, about the subject or about the student or any of those things. So I brought to you one small slide where you can look at it, you will understand it. I have put different things, all these things you can put as a way or in a way called as a perspective. It could be a critical analysis, it could be thinking, it could be questioning, it could be interpretation, it could be exploring, it could be rethinking, it could be creativity or creative thinking, it can be reflection or reflecting or reasoning. All these things will bring you a point of view or a perspective. That is how I would define philosophy in a way, as a point of view or as a perspective. So when you look at and try to understand how this philosophy emerged and what are the different knowledge domains that have come into existence, then I would say these are the three branches. This, some of the books, if you read, they call them as branches of philosophy. Some of them call them as problems of philosophy. Some of them view it as scope of philosophy. Any of these things meaning the same thing. That is, what is the holistic perspective that you develop about philosophy? When you read these three things, you will be able to understand what is basic philosophy. Then we will try to understand educational philosophy by applying all these principles or all this knowledge to the field of education, or while teaching in the classroom, or while designing the curriculum, or anything. I'll come to that point in due course of discussion. So when I look at the scope or branches or problems of philosophy, because man was wondering in the beginning about the reality, what is real, what is real, who is real, whether God is real, whether matter is real, whether this physical world is real, or the universe is real, what is real, whether me, human being, is real, who is real, what is real. So like that, there are many, many questions came into human mind. Then he started wondering and tried to find out what is that ultimate reality. So everybody started visualizing. The whole history will tell you about Milesian thinkers and pre-sophist period and sophist period and medieval period. And if you look into the whole development of philosophical knowledge came into existence through varied philosophers, you know, wondering about the world, about the reality. So any philosophy, when you look at the standard philosophical discourses or texts, will reveal to you these three branches of philosophy or these three problems they deal from their point of view. If you look at pragmatism, from the pragmatic, practical point of view, they look at what is reality. They say experience is real. If you look at idealists, they say idea is real. So like that, from their own ideology or point of view, their visualization about what is the ultimate reality, what is the reality, like that they question and they start answering to that question from their own philosophical, ideological point of view. So like that, metaphysics, a branch of philosophy which deal with reality, will speak about three issues, very, very important to say any standard philosophy. If you accept there will be discussions about reality with respect to God, with respect to self, with respect to world. When you talk about the God, there may be people who believe in God, we call them theists. Those people who do not believe in God, we call them as atheists. That means they don't believe in the existence of God. So when you deal with God or theology or theism or atheism or in general about the perceptions on God, there are varied viewpoints about God that I'll discuss in the next discussion. Once let me give you a holistic view about all three branches, then I'll go into details of each and every branch of it. So when you look at God, God is one dimension related to reality about the existence of God. Whether God exists, if exists, where is that God? Can you show me that God? So if you go on discussing, theologists will give lot of interpretations about the existence of God, and atheists also will give you lot of interpretations and justifications how God doesn't exist. So there are different branches, are within the existence of God, there are different branches or different theories which have come into existence, like monies, the theists and deists and anthropomorphists, like the different ways they looked at the God, that we will discuss. And similarly about the self, when you say, there is a huge debate, time immemorial, Descartes came out with certain discourses and many other philosophers also discussed about whether self is real or mind is real or both are real. This is a huge debate, unending or never ending debate. Some of us feel both mind and body are same. Some of us feel both mind and body are different. Like that which are different is understood by idealists, because idealists feel mind is something totally different from body. When you look at naturalists, they feel mind and body both are made of matter, so both are same. Like that there are people who believe in one as a real self is only one, or self is both mind and body. So this duality of debates have gone into the discourses of philosophers over a period of time, from time immemorial. Simply speaking, self is a big debate about whether it is mind or whether it is body or something much more than mind and body. So some people or philosophers view it is the inner soul or spirit as the real self, not the physical self or physical body which you all visualize. So like that we have varied discourses from the point of view of different philosophies. So like that you can see self is another component related to reality. Similarly, world view. What is world? Whether this world exists? How does this world exist? Is there anything that exists exterior to this world or beyond this world? So something like that people started questioning and started exploring, started finding new knowledge or different knowledge about this whole world and universe as such. So earlier people used to think different versions exist, different things exist in this whole world. So they used to call it as multiverse in the beginning of the knowledge. Then gradually they realized it is not different, everything is same. Suppose if you see, there are varied atoms exist in this whole structure of matter. But when you see the inner core of the matter, it is one and the same. The matter constitutes, the matter becomes one when all these molecules and elements come together. So that's how the later course of time science has realized, and ultimately, you know, finalized, or even philosophers have realized it is not a multiverse, but it is a universe. Reason why today also in physics we call this world as a universe. So like that universal laws, universal values, like that you get so much of discourse on universe. So about the world, when you are looking at who are the philosophers who believe in one reality as monies, those who believe not one reality as one, ultimate reality as one, but ultimate realities are more than one or two. When it is two, it is called dualism. When it is more than two, it is called the pluralism. Like that, this whole worldview has been visualized by varied philosophers as monism, dualism and pluralism, like that. So this is first branch of philosophy, or first problem to encounter by man and find new knowledge about the God, about the self and about the world. Similarly, you have about the self and other things. Then the second branch or problem, or in the scope of philosophy, we consider it as the episteme or epistemology. Episteme, when you say it is knowing, episteme means it is knowing. Epistemology is a branch of knowledge or a branch of philosophy which deal with knowledge. That means construction of knowledge about this whole universe, or about the God, about the self, or about the whole lot of your experiences in this world, you construct knowledge. How do you construct knowledge? You know, this whole branch of philosophy which deals with construction or understanding or knowing about various things in this world, That is the reason you call it as epistemology, as a branch of philosophy which deal with theory of knowledge. So when you construct this knowledge or develop this knowledge or understand this knowledge, create new knowledge, then you may use various approaches or means or the methodologies. You may use a reason as a methodology. So we call that kind of a knowledge which comes through or which evolves through reasoning is called a rational knowledge. Some knowledge which you come across or you experience through your own personal experience. For example, you taste a fruit. When you taste a fruit, you know whether it is bitter or sweet or sour. So it is your experience which gives you a knowledge that mango is sweet in taste, or some jam or some guava is sweet in taste, or some other thing, lime is, you know, sour in taste. Like that, you get various experiences by your own sensorial experiences or through your other feelings and emotions when you get connected to the rational experiences. Sometimes intuitive experiences also you may have. But broadly speaking, the empirical is where you have some sensorial interaction or interconnectivity or experiences that you come across and try to get or acquire some knowledge. So through experience, whatever you get the knowledge, that knowledge is called empirical knowledge. But there are also people who don't believe in any kind of knowledge. They believe that it is impossible to get any ultimate knowledge. So such people are called as agnostics, or you call it as agnosticism. Similarly, like Descartes, I said, I think therefore I am. And he said, doubt every knowledge or doubt everything that comes before you. So we can say such people who doubt the knowledge or who doubt everything and then come out with reason and then finally arrive at the knowledge. So these people who are skeptical, they are doubtful about every knowledge, you call them as skepticism or skeptics or skeptical knowledge. Similarly, there are scientists or scientific field. All scientific knowledge comes out, either it starts with the observation and then it ends with the experimentation, with the proof and justification. So like that, all science evolves, or all scientific knowledge evolves through observation, and especially when you finalize, you prove it through the experiment. You hypothesize it, you experiment it, and then you prove it. So experimental knowledge is that knowledge which comes out or which comes through experimentation, where you do the verification through the experiment. It could be a chemical analysis, or it could be a dissection when you do in biology and know about any part of the body or know about the nervous system in an earthworm, in a human being, or anything. So you are experiencing, you are able to see that, you are able to visualize it, and you are able to justify, or that fact you are able to agree it, approve it, and then say it is the fact, it is correct, or it is evident, it is right knowledge. So like that, through experimental proof, you can say it is a right knowledge. So the knowledge which is acquired through experience, empirical knowledge, which is acquired through reasoning is rational knowledge, which is acquired through doubting is skeptical knowledge, where you don't agree with any knowledge, agnostic knowledge, and through experimental knowledge, through observation, observational knowledge. So like that, these are all various means and various mechanisms, various methodologies which we use in our day-to-day life to acquire knowledge. But when it becomes very standard knowledge, or when they construct this knowledge and it is universally approved, then it becomes the approved knowledge. Whether it is philosophers or scientists or different people who have created this knowledge which is approved by the universe or everybody, then it becomes a standard knowledge. Whether it is science or sociology, philosophy, political science, any disciplinary knowledge, when it is established or when it is approved by people through various mechanisms, through reasoning or justification or scientific proof or anything, there it becomes the constructed knowledge. So like that, the second branch of philosophy deals with the knowledge. Then third branch of knowledge, which deals with values. This particular topic will be dealt at length in some other chapter, where you will be talking about the whole lot. Even about epistemology, I will touch upon in some other topic or the next chapter or next unit I will be dealing with you there. I will talk much more about it. But here let me stop with a limited giving you a kind of a awareness and overview about what episteme at all. Episteme means to know. Knowing anything, you know, you construct something. You will know about something that will create some new information or new facts or new knowledge, new theories, new paradigms, new axioms. So like that, you will evolve a knowledge about something. It could be a common man knowledge, or it could be a knowledge of the specialists in their own respective disciplinary areas. So like that, this branch, in a way, I would say episteme is the root for any knowledge. That's the reason sometimes we say philosophy is mother of all disciplines. That's the reason why when you do the research and create new knowledge, you are doing a research inquiry, you are doing philosophical epistemological process itself is inquiring into the knowledge which you don't know. Then you create that new knowledge. That is what our research does. That is how new knowledge is created. That is how episteme itself, the knowing itself, creates knowledge. So any disciplinary knowledge, reason why we say philosophy is mother of all disciplines. Then axiology, as I told you, it is the branch of philosophy which deal with theory of values. So about the values, it could be mores, it could be standards, or it could be norms. That is all related to ethics. Ethics deal with the mores, standards, all those values. It could be universal values, it could be relative values, it could be subjective, objective, physical or social, or economic values, any kind of values. This whole discourse will happen in another unit in detail with all the examples. We will deal with that in the later course of our presentations. But for our understanding about ethics, this axiology covers three aspects. One is ethics. Ethics deal with mores. Mores means the morality part of it, the moral values or morality, the kind of ethical aspects, human ethics, human dealing with the virtues or vices, when you know what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is bad, what to do, what not to do. These all rationalization and discretion power will come only when you are having the morality and conscious about these moralistic aspects. So that morality speaks about the mores and standards. Standards can be set, you know, for your own education there are standards, for your own institution there are standards, for books there are standards, for everything in this world we have created certain standards. It should be like this. So you will create some criteria against which it has to prove, then you will call it as a standard. Suppose you have ISI mark, AGU mark, the products will get some kind of standard marking. This mark will say that it is a product which is approved, which you can buy, which has some higher value, which can be bought. So like that, we buy so many things in the market. There are trades, there are marks, you know, so many labels you have. Levi's product, if you see a clothing with a Levi's mark or somebody's mark, so then you will agree it and you will, without it thinking, you will just buy that product, whatever value it has. So like that, you will establish certain standards for all aspects. Similarly, in education, we have educational standards for our institutions, our own teaching and other issues. So like that, more standards and norms, you establish certain norms, you know, some norms will be there, you have to do like that. Suppose every day when you are going to the school or an institution, you are given some norms. You have to come at 9 o'clock in the morning. Your class is about 45 minutes. You should stay back in the school, or you must visit a laboratory. Certain norms in the institution you create. Like that, political norms, for various things there are various norms established. So all those things are dealt by philosophy under its axiology, under ethics. So ethics deal with more standards and norms. Similarly, another aspect which is dealt is aesthetics. Aesthetic deal with beauty and appreciation. Any teacher who is teaching in the classroom should be able to appreciate the children when they are learning. Whatever they learn, you should be able to appreciate. And you should know the beauty and discover the beauty of learning process and learners and the whole context as such. And you should be able to appreciate everything around you. You should not find fault and become judgmental in your dealing with children or dealing with anybody around you. So you should develop that ability and aptitude to appreciate things around you, whatever beauty it has, whatever little amount of things that are good with anybody, you should be able to appreciate. So aesthetic deal with appreciation and understanding and discovering the beauty from anything. Even if a child who is dirty, you should be able to discover the beauty from the child, what is good in the child. So like that, the teacher should develop that point of appreciation and then able to discover the beauty in everything around its own environment and context. So like that, aesthetic deal with the beauty and appreciation and other issues. So, which is very much necessary for a teacher, especially while teaching in the classroom context, and should be able to create that aesthetic environment in the classroom where children should be able to appreciate the beauty of the classroom in terms of arrangement or in terms of teaching learning process, in terms of teaching aids that you are using, anything that should be appreciable by the child and enjoy the beauty of your classroom. So like that, this branch will give you a perspective to the teacher, how I can create that beautiful environment in the classroom, how I can create that appreciable things in my classroom, how can I create and how can create that kind of an attitude amongst my children in the classroom. So like that, this branch helps the teacher to become a teacher who can really appreciate the whole lot of it. Similarly, the other aspect of axiology deals with logic. Logic is inductive and deductive. All of you know about these things who are in science and mathematics, who deal with induction and deduction, or logic as inductive logic, deductive logic. While deriving the equation, or maybe in all your mathematical formulae, you use the deduction and induction as a logic. Whole of mathematics is just a process of reasoning. Reasoning deals with induction or deduction. Especially when you deal with inductive logic, you know, most of our scientific knowledge came into existence because of the inductive reasoning. That is, the specifics you observe. Maybe if I throw any number of objects up before that space, all those objects fall down to the ground. That means, why these bodies are falling to the ground? It is because of gravity. How Newton has discovered this law of gravity? It is because of the observations he made, n number of observations when you make, and when you arrive at generalization, that means the specific experiences which lead to some generalization, then you call it as inductive logic. That means induction helps you to derive from specifics to come out with a generalization. So that's how the unification or generalization of the knowledge or justification of the knowledge through induction comes in all our sciences, because it should be proved anywhere. If you take gravity, law of gravity, or Newtonian laws, or Heisenberg's law principle, or any scientific knowledge, when you take it, it is proved, or it can be proved anywhere universally. It is proved under certain conditions. So all our science is a kind of inductive reasoning through experimentation, through proofs and verification, which comes only with the specific experiences. When n number of specific experiences are proved similarly, then it comes out with a generalization. That becomes a principle, a law, a theory, an axiom, or a paradigm. So like that, most of the scientific knowledge is created because of this specific to generalization induction. Similarly, maths and other subjects, which philosophy and other issues where you cannot experiment, then you will use, especially in Greek earlier times, during Aristotelian period, inductive logic is given by the modern scientist Bacon, deductive logic is given by Aristotle in the ancient times of Greek period. So there, that time we don't have this science as such. They used to use only these discourses in their metaphysical clubs. And they used to go from generality to specification. I will give a simple example. All men are mortal, then Aristotle is a man, therefore he is mortal. That means all men, when you are taking a general premise or the major premise, major statement or a proposition, this proposition is speaking about general. That is, every human being, all men are mortal. Whoever took birth on this earth, they have to die one day. They are not immortal. They are all mortal. So anybody who take birth as man has to die one day. So they are all mortal. So whoever is a man, that is not woman, men, but here we are talking about human race. So whoever is taking birth as human being, he has to die one day. So that's how this particular three premises, major premise and the two minor, one minor premise, then you will come out with the conclusion. So all men are mortal, Aristotle is a man, therefore you conclude. How do you conclude? Because in that proposition you have seen all men are mortal, Aristotle is a man. What is left there? Moral. The mortal is left there. So therefore he is a mortal being. So like that, the deduction comes from a generality. First is the major premise, which is a generally applicable things to anybody. So you apply to any specific thing, then if it is proved, then it is same. So like that, the deduction process or logic is used. But earlier times, during the pragmatic philosophy, Charles Sanders Peirce used another logic called abductive logic, which was not foolproof as inductive logic or deductive logic. So that particular logic was not become or could not become a universally approved logic. But still, I would, passing reference, I'll tell you a simple example. I'll tell you, there is a stable by Z which has all horses brown in color. So if some horses are nearby that particular stable Z, you can arrive at a conclusion that these horses may belong to that particular stable Z. But there is also a possibility that these horses may not belong to that particular stable Z. So this is the gap that is there. So this particular logic was not approved by all the metaphysical clubs of philosophers during those Greek times. So this particular logic is no more approved as the finally approved logic on par with inductive logic or deductive logic. So I am giving you this in a nutshell. This whole slide will try to tell you in a gist form all these branches of philosophy which I have been explaining to you. So this few more things which I thought I would explain further, I would just give you in this God, about God, when you are looking at understanding the God under the metaphysics, the existence of God. As I told you, the broad categories are theists and atheists, those who believe that God exists, the God existence is real, those are all called theists. Those who say that God do not exist, they all belong to atheists. But within the theism, that is who believe in God, somebody are also agnostics who do not believe in any possibility of existence of God. But there are also people who believe in deism, that is, the God is one who is the lawgiver and who is the creator of this whole world. So this particular group who believes that God is the creator and God is the lawgiver, lawgiver in the sense that who will judge what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is bad, about all these things about this world, how man gets to know about all these things. So that particular group of people who believe that God is the creator and lawgiver, they are called as deists and deism, that particular theology which believes in God. Similarly, people who believe, especially Christianity, believes all is God and God is all. So pantheism is that particular theology which believes that God is the one God is the only one, everything is God. That means he is all pervading, omniscient, omnipresent, like that we say, no, everything is God. So like that all is God, God is all. So like that pantheism, as a group of philosophers who came out, theologists who came out and said this is pantheism. Similarly, there is a group of people, even now we have so many Babas, so many, you know, Murshids and so many people whom we believe and almost they are identified as gods. If you see different Dashavataras in Indian Hinduistic philosophies or Hinduistic theologies, if you see, everywhere you see so many gods. Of course, in Hinduism or in our ancient philosophies, they say Brahmana, you know, Rishis speak many things, they speak many things, but ultimate reality is one, ultimate God is one. You know, Vipra Vadanti, Bahuda Vadanti, but Satyam, Satyam Ekam, Satyam Ekam, that is, Satyam is, that is, truth is only one, Satyam Ekam, Vipra Vadanti Bahuda, that means the Brahmanas speak in different ways. Like, you know, we visualize God in different forms, could be Rama, could be Krishna, could be in various forms we visualize God, but all are one, that is Ekam Sat, Satyam is one, all gods are only one. So that is the reality, but people believe in plurality of gods, and some of them believe that human being who has taken the form of the god, like Rama or Krishna, these are all have come into in the godhead. Godhead came into human, you know, evolution process, or human being, as a human being they took birth, but they created that godly creation in this world and made human beings to realize what is God and what are the qualities of God. So that group of people are called as anthropomorphists, that means who believe that human being who took birth with Godhead as gods. So like that anthropomorphism is another theistic group who believes that human being with Godhead as God. So that group of people are called anthropomorphists and anthropomorphism. Similarly, those who do not believe in the existence of God, as I told you, agnosticism, agnosticism, both in terms of knowledge as well as in terms of any knowledge for that matter. So is the case with a God, they don't believe. Similarly, as I told you, world about the monism, dualism and pluralism. So there you have this whole world. When you look at this whole world, ultimately it is going to become one. If you look into Eastern, most of the Eastern philosophies, if you look at Sankhya philosophy, they talk because of the evolution and dissolution. When it dissolves back, everything is one. When it evolves into different things, that means this whole life came into existence from unicellular to multicellular organisms which have evolved. So many different forms the life exists, so many different forms the beings exist, so many different forms the things exist. That's how this whole world came into existence and evolved. And when dissolution happens, when destruction happens, again it comes back to one thing. So like that, when you understand the gist of it, the core of the reality about this whole world, then you realize this is all one, then that group of people who believe that reality is only one, they are called as monists, and that branch is, or that philosophy is called as monism. Similarly, those who believe two are real, only God is real. Suppose in monism, only God is real, only world is real, only self is real. If you believe only in one thing, they are all monists. If somebody feel no, world is also real, self is also real, or God is real, self is real. Like that, if they believe in two things, then they are called as dualists. That means they believe in two realities as the ultimate reality. So what is that ultimate? But somebody like me and you may think that everything looks to me as real. Man is real, world is real, God is real, every being is real. Then I am believing in more than two realities. Then that group is called as pluralism, or pluralists they are called as. Like that, this whole branch of philosophy speaks about plurality of realities as the ultimate reality. So whether ultimate reality is one, two, or many, depending upon that group of thinkers and who believes in that particular reality, they are grouped under monists, dualists, and pluralistic philosophers. About how you can understand this whole philosophy and why we need this philosophy at all, how is it going to help for the students or prospective teachers or forthcoming, future teachers, how they are going to use this particular philosophy. So if you just understand any school of thought, we don't have time now to discuss about that. In the next classes, we will deal about detail about each philosophy. So every philosophy, whatever philosophy they believe in, whatever metaphysics, epistemology, and axiology they have, basically what do they believe in? What is the ultimate reality that they believe? If you see, idealists believe in idealism, idea as reality, absolute reality, and pragmatists believe experience as reality, naturalists believe nature as reality. So based on that, they will suggest the system to be given or education to be given, in that process to be given to the child. So in that case, the whole of education system, that the scope of this whole education is, going to deal with one pyramid. If you understand, I shall tell you, if time permits, I will go to that particular point and discuss with you. So any philosophy is the ideology. So you have some ideology, your own point of view. From that point of view, you will establish some broad aims for you to achieve at the end of the day. So those aims, with those aims, you try to design some material. We call it as curriculum. And with the curriculum, what you do? You have to transact or teach this particular content or the material to children. Then according to the material, or appropriate to the material, you need to select the methodology, that is experimental method, or any method you take for that matter, experimental, demonstration, lecture method, collaborative method, cooperative method, project method, any method you take. So this method should be appropriate or suitable to the topic or concept or the discipline or the content or the material that you are teaching. So this particular philosophy will have some aim. I wanted to have the development or inculcation of values amongst the children. That is my aim. So this particular aim is more towards the humanism. When you talk about humanism, this is more close to the idealistic ideology. So that humanistic individuals you want to create, that is your aim. You want to inculcate absolute values in all these children, because you want to make them human beings. So your aim is to inculcate the values or exalt the personality of the child. So when personality, you say it is very much inside of the child, which you have to draw it out. It is not a small thing. So it's a broad aim to be achieved over a period of time. So to achieve this particular aim, you may set some goals, short-term goals, long-term goals. Then ultimately you try to achieve them in the classroom through the objectives. So these objectives, when you set before you for the classroom teaching, suppose I am teaching you today after my class, I wanted to achieve that all my students should understand what is the concept of philosophy, what are the different branches of philosophy, what is the scope of education or educational philosophy they should understand. That is my objective, immediate objective. But ultimately, I want them to develop a perspective for them. That is my aim. So what is my ideology? I want to develop an eclectic philosophy, not go to any one philosophy, but try to understand all philosophies and arrive at your own perspective or ideology while teaching in the classroom. So like that, educational philosophy will deal with the aims which come from ideology. That means you as a teacher should have an ideology of your own or a perspective of your own. From that, you arrive at the aims. From these aims, you derive your curriculum. To achieve this aim, suppose inculcation of values, if I say, how do these values can be inculcated in children? I may use material as a storytelling. So I can tell them a moral story. Then I can inculcate some moral values in the children. I can tell them an economic related story. I can instill in them economic values. So if I want to inculcate values in them as my, you know, aim of education, then I use my material in my curriculum as something related to the matter. Is material is I am using a story as my content. So for story, I may use a narrative, I may use a role play, or I may use different methodologies and teach them that particular lesson. Then that is the methodology. Methodology always has a connect to the curriculum or the content. Then based on my teaching processes, I use the evaluation mechanism. Suppose if I am giving method as a role play, then I will observe them. What is my evaluation tool here? I have to observe the role play of children, characters of children, and if they have understood that whole story and developed those morality in them, then I can say my evaluation is only observation. Or if it is some content matter, if I have taught them, if I ask them to write a definition, I can use a quantitative method of evaluation. I test them, I give them score if they have given me correct answer. So like that, evaluation depends on again your aim, your curriculum, your method, and then evaluation tools or evaluation techniques or evaluation method that you have used. So these all things will revolve between two people who are very, very important. One end is the teacher, the other end is the pupil or the learner. So these people, how they should be, how, what are duties or functions or role of a teacher, what is the role of the pupil. In different contexts, the role of the teacher, the role of the pupil will keep changing. If it is an idealistic environment, the role of the teacher is something different. He is a disciplinarian who will control the whole classroom, who will go for establishing or inculcating ideals amongst the children. This whole lot of it is mostly the teacher will visualize something and achieve that something ultimately at the end of the day. So the teacher, student will not have that amount of freedom as you have in naturalism. Naturalistic teacher is very free, and they will leave them to their complete freedom will be given to the child. It is mostly child-centric approach the teacher will use. So the role of the teacher and role of that student will keep changing as per your ideology, which will give you aims, which will give you curriculum, which will give you methods and all. So depending upon your own ideological point of view or perspective of teaching, your role of the teacher and your role of the student will keep changing. Similarly, the kind of disciplinary mechanisms that you are using or disciplinary practices that you adopt in the classroom keep vary again according to your ideology or the philosophy. So that's how you can see how important is philosophical understanding for all the teachers to enable them to adopt appropriate philosophies in the classroom and adjust them to the in the classroom and try to give the best to the children in the classroom. So this is how we can understand. To sum up, I can say the teacher should become a holistic, humanistic individual in the classroom who deal with children in a very, very passionate way, in an affectionate way, with a clear ideology of their own, a point of view of their own, and try to give them the best that they can give and maintain a beautiful interpersonal relationships in the classroom and enable them, empower them, emancipate them, inspire them in the classroom. This can happen only when a teacher learns appropriately what is this philosophy subject as such and how educational philosophy evolves by applying all the principles of philosophical theories and philosophical principles to the whole lot of education or teaching learning process in the classroom. Thank you very much for having patient listening, and we will continue this discourse with another concept on education and relation between education and philosophy.